who were affected today. We thank you for what you have done starting from last week's Sunday. We thank you, Lord Almighty, for Pastor Adebiyi. We thank you, Lord Almighty, for Evangelist Oshoda that ministered on Thursday. We thank you, Lord Almighty, for Pastor Iwole at the night vigil. We thank you, Lord Almighty, for Minister Omoson. We thank you, Lord Almighty, for Mike Aremu. We thank you for Sister Adora. We thank you for Don Moyne. We thank you for Mercy City Chapel. We thank you, Lord Almighty, for everyone that ministered that night. We appreciate you. Lord Almighty, as we come together today, Lord Almighty, our gathering shall not be in vain.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Father, Lord, I thank you. Ancient of days, I glorify you. For in Jesus Christ's name, we have prayed.
Amen.
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 Brethren, let's have our seats. Brethren, I would love to appreciate everyone. And today, I want to talk on, as we conclude our Seeking His Presence series, I want to conclude on a topic that have a sermon that have with the topic of achieving your purpose. Achieving your what? Purpose. Our theme for this year is fulfilling God's purpose. And we thank God that Pastor Adebiyi was able to talk to us on that. When Evangelist Oshoda prayed on Tuesday, it was on purpose. Friday, we ministered on purpose, on how God will favor us. And today, I want to close on how to achieve, or achieving your purpose. Achieving your what? Purpose. And our scripture reading will be from the book of Mark 6, 32 to 44. Mark 6, 32 to 44. Please always come with your Bible and let's open together and let's study the word of God together. Our service will be a little bit late just because of a lot of things we are doing. Mark 6, 32 to 44. I will read. It says, so they departed to a deserted place in the boat by themselves. But the multitude saw them departing, and many knew him, and ran there on foot from all the cities. They arrived before and came together to him. And Jesus, when he came out, saw a great multitude, and was moved with compassion for them, because they were like a sheep, not having a shepherd. So he began to teach them many things. When the day was now far spent, his disciples came to him and said, this is a deserted place, and already the hour is late. So send them away, that they may go into the surrounding country and villages and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat. 37. But he answered and said to them, you give them something to eat. You give them something to eat. And they said back to him, shall we go and buy 200 denarii worth of bread and give them something to eat? But he said to them, how many loaves do you have? Go and see. And when they found out, they said, 5 and 2 fishes. 39. Then he commanded them to make them all sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in ranks, in hundreds and in fifties. And when he had taken the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes, he looked up into heaven, blessed and broke the loaves, and gave them to his disciples to set before them. And the 2 fish he divided among them all. So they all ate and were filled. And they took up 12 baskets full of fragments and of fish. Now, those who had eaten the loaves were about 5,000 men. Brethren, I want to talk to us this morning on achieving our purpose. We have said a lot of things about purpose. We have said a lot of things about how God brings us to this life to achieve a purpose. But today, I want to talk to us on some principles that will help us after all we have learned this week. Some principles that will help us. I don't know what your expectations are, but brethren, I want to tell as many as are here today that the Lord did not bring you here by mistake. You are here to listen to this. You are here this weekend. It's an appointed time in your life to forge ahead in your destiny. And I have no doubt in my spirit that as from today, somebody's life is moving ahead in the mighty name of Jesus. You are moving closer and closer unto your destiny. I don't know what your expectations are. I don't know what you are believing God for. But I want you to know that as from today, I want you to begin to expect good things to happen to you. You have received the anointing. You have been anointed. You have prayed. Brethren, after David was anointed, the next thing that started to happen in his life, he was started to move forward. And I declare upon your life, you are moving forward. In the mighty name of Jesus. Don't expect bad things to happen to you. What surprises me in life is that people wake up every day and they all claim negative things. Oh, I hope this will not happen. I hope that will not happen. Why don't you say for a change that today I'm waking up a champion. Today I'm covered with favor. Today, good things will be attracted unto me. Today, men will favor me. Men will favor me. Brethren, there is power in the tongue. What you say matters a lot. Don't confess negatively unto yourself. As from today, go out, step out into the world, and begin to do those things that you have never done before. Brethren, what surprises me is that many people don't know that they are not the ones making this thing happen. It is the Lord that makes it happen for you. All you have to do is to do what? Step out in faith, confess it, and God had already prepared a place, somebody to help you. Brother Shalwa was sharing with me, we asked some of us in the Seeking His Presence group to raise money. He did his own part. He said, just send out the envelope. So he came up with a testimony. He said, Pastor, someone that I was expecting $100 from just said to me that the Lord said he should give $1,000. He said, that's surprising. But he was very humbled. He was shaking because he said, he does not even think the person can even. I said, that's how the Lord works. The Lord has prepared a table before you in the presence of your enemies. But then all you have to do is to come to the table ready to do what? Eat. And you are going to eat until you are full. You are going to eat what you want. You are going to eat what you like. In the mighty name of Jesus. Go out, brethren, this season, and begin to do exploits. And the Lord will help you in Jesus' name. Matthew 5:15. What are your expectations? I'm talking about, what are your expectations? Matthew 5:15 says, neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. Brethren, you are the light of this world. You are the salt of this world. Brethren, if there is no salt in a food, it does not taste well. If there is no light in a room, brethren, people cannot see. I want to tell you, brethren, that as from today, anywhere you go to, you will not be intimidated. In the mighty name of Jesus. Men will see you and they will help you. Women will see you and they will do what? And they will help you. Many are not saying amen because they don't understand what it takes for you to enter into a place, for somebody to give you a call from nowhere and say to you that we have chosen you. Brethren, it shall happen to you. I want you to believe it. I want you to say amen. I want you to know that God is ready. He has prepared a table for you, and you shall be partakers of it in the mighty name of Jesus. Brethren, the Bible is a book that gives us practical example. That gives us what? Practical example on how to live our life. How to face challenges on the face of the earth. The Bible is not only a serious book, because a lot of us, when we think about the Bible, we think about the Bible of a serious thing that we only need to read when bad things are about to happen. You know, when we are young, the only time we go into the scripture is when some prophet give us some Bible scriptures. That read Isaiah 101, read Matthew, read this one, bad thing will not happen. You put it under your table. The Bible is more than that. The challenge is that a lot of us, because of our cultural background, look at the Bible as something that stops bad things from happening. It does that. Not only does it do that, it does a lot more than that. The Bible, brethren, inherent in the Bible are principles of life that will help every one of us grow and get to our expected end. The Bible, brethren, is a book that has principles. When you talk about principles, brethren, the Bible is the only place that you get 90%, 100% principles that will affect you positively on the face of the earth. A lot of us see the Bible as something that when you're about to die, the man of God will come and read the scriptures and say to you that where you are going to, this is what you are going to expect. Even the man that is saying it, know that you are not likely to expect it, but just saying it, that you are going somewhere. He knows that everything you have done in life is to hurt mankind. But it's believing God that God will help you. Brethren, I pray for you today. As from today, the Bible will be your friend. In the mighty name of Jesus. So, brethren, I want you to understand. I want you to understand that there are principles that are greater. No other principles are greater than the principles that we have in the Bible. 1 Corinthians 1:25 tells us, for the foolishness of God is wiser than what? Human wisdom. And the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Even while you think that what the Bible says, some of us think that what the Bible says, oh, it's not something that I need to. Even the foolishness of God is much more stronger and much more wiser than human wisdom. And where you think God is weak, brethren, is much, more stronger than your own strength. So if that is the case, why don't you and I rely on the Bible to help us in every single thing that we do? Brethren, someone was sharing with me after a testimony, wonderful testimony in the last 3 weeks. He said, Pastor, I will now serve God more. Wow! That is all my ministry is all about. I will now serve God more. Because the person saw in face to face how God is able to walk. It was like you being a dead end, cornered, and the Lord did what? Brought you out. And the blood delivered the person. Brethren, I pray for you today. As you put your strength in the Bible, the Lord will help you in Jesus' name. Brethren, the Bible is so simple and it's so powerful. The problem is that you and I has been deceived over time. And I want you to move back and make sure that you concentrate on what the Bible has told you and you will not fail in Jesus' name. It says to us, the foolishness of man and the foolishness of God is much more wiser than the foolishness of man. And I pray that God will help us all in Jesus' name. I said, God will help us all in Jesus' name. Brethren, I'm going to give us three principles quickly. And I want you to write down because it's going to help your life. I want you to write it down because it will help you get to where God wants you to be. I have practiced one of these things in my life. Brethren, it is helping me and it's going to help you. One, accept responsibility for change. Accept what? Responsibility for change. Accept responsibility for change. Brethren, life works from the inside to the outside. Life, the Bible even tells us, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So therefore, life works from the inside to the outside. You have to make up your mind to make a change within. And when you make a change within, that change now translates to what comes outside. When we had when kings gathered with the men, we talked about self-esteem, we talked about self-image. Brethren, your self-esteem is what you think about yourself. Your self-image is what you portray outside, and what you are and what you portray outside. Brethren, you must make up your mind that you must make a change inside. If the way you are living 3 years ago, 4 years ago, and it's not working for you, then you must decide that let me make a change. And it must start from inside. The amazing thing, brethren, is how people blame everybody else except for themselves for what happens to them. Oh, pastor, it is this. Oh, it is that. Nothing is caused by the person who has the challenge. They always think it's somebody else. Tell somebody there must be a change. Brethren, when you try to correct someone, you try to correct some people, they give excuses and you're like, wow. They blame others, brethren, for every single thing that happens to themselves. Something about excuses. Something about excuses. Excuses prevent you from seeing the resources of tomorrow. Excuses does what? Prevents you from seeing the what? Resources of tomorrow. Remember, when you give excuses, what you are saying that one or two things is not possible. Is that true? And God begins to bring things your way that will help you. But you are not seeing it. Because the only thing you are seeing is that, oh, it is because of this, it is because of that. Remember, this blame thing goes along with the blame syndrome. Adam blamed the woman. The woman blamed the snake. Is that true? Adam blamed the woman. The woman did what? Blamed the snake. It's all about blames. Oh, why did that happen? It is this woman. Why did that happen? It is the snake. Why can't we, for once, take responsibility? It's a result of the fall of man that this blame thing came into the face of the earth. Oh, it is because I was not born in America. If my parents had money to send me to one of the best schools in Nigeria, or in Ghana, or in Liberia, or in Congo, it would have been better for me. Oh, it is because I'm not white. It is the color. It is my accent. Brethren, we have examples of people in this country that have worse accents than you, and the Lord is blessing them. Arnold Schwarzenegger is an example. He's a man in California. Even in the movies, they will do every single thing to do everything on his voice. At times, you don't hear him. But trust me, when he was the governor of California, you dare not say you can't hear him. Is that true? Or else he will do what? Fire you. It's time you begin to take responsibility. Don't say, oh, I got to this country at the age of 35. It might be too late for me. There's nothing late for your God. Am I saying something to somebody? There's nothing too late for your God. Only if a fraction of people understand that those that are doing very well in life, they only have little qualitative education. People that are doing very well in life, that you see the Microsoft, they didn't have a humble beginning. Steve Jobs, they had a humble beginning. Arnold Schwarzenegger was a foreigner like you and I. President Obama, we all know his story. Not that they were born with gold spoon. These people struggled, and God made it happen for them. And I'm saying to you today, when you understand that, and you decide to correct yourself and make something out of your life, God will help you. You already have the Bible behind you, supporting you. All you have to do is to rise up and understand that God will make it happen for you in Jesus' name. Brethren, Daniel in the Bible, if you look at the story of the Bible, Daniel in the Bible will say, oh, I'm a captive in Babylon, but God helped him. Joseph will have said, the reason why I didn't go anywhere in life is why? Because my brothers hated me so much. Am I saying something? That my brothers did what? Hated me so much. Joseph will say, my brothers hated me so much. Obama will say, you know what? How can I be a president of this country? No black man has ever been there. Brethren, with God on your side, all things are possible. But brethren, talk is cheap. How are you in your heart going out to achieve this? If you look at me by the grace of God as the humble servant here, I press on every day. I press on every day. What can we do together as a church? Where can we go? There's nothing too big for us to do. I was awed. Don Moen has traveled all over the world. All over the world. He came to this church and he said, wow, what a hospitality. These are people that have all over the world. And he was awed by the service that we gave unto him. Mike Aramu said the same thing to it who has traveled. He has been in Europe for almost maybe 1 or 2 months. There is nothing difficult for you and I. Your thinking must change. You must understand that you have the image of God in you. And because God is on your side, nobody can be against you. And you are confessing it every day. I live a life of favor. I live a life of miracle. But God is on my side. And you see how God doors will open for you. And I pray for you today that God will help you in Jesus' name. David would have said, oh, I'm 8 out of many children. How is God going to help him? Did God help him? God help me. Our God is no respecter of any human being. No respecter of anyone. But then, if you have excuses, if you let those excuses stop you, you are likely to go down the drain. What you must do is you must decide to start afresh. You must decide to do what? Start afresh. Once you give an excuse, you are giving that excuse a power to control you. What does it mean? Oh, I need to carry this thing. And you are saying, oh, but I don't have the strength. Forgetting the fact that the Bible says that in your weakness, God is there for you. Is that true? But if you now give that excuse that I cannot carry it, why? Because it's too heavy for me. You are giving that too heavy for me power to control your life. Is that true? Something is saying, carry it. You are saying it's too heavy. Something is saying, carry it. You are saying it's too heavy. Brethren, the world is our domain. This world might be for few people, but it's okay. The world is our what? Domain. Sometimes last year, Delatoro came here, but maybe 4 years, Delatoro McNeil came here. And Delatoro said something. He said, don't, Pastor Linde, go out. Wow. It was as if I never had that before. That was for me. I moved out, and God is helping me. If you get to Miles Monroe Church in the Bahamas, Miles Monroe Church is not more than maybe, but the man has made the whole world his domain. Is that true? It's affecting everywhere in the world. But then you must go out. When Minister Omosa must have started, she would not have known where God is going to take her with her music. But today, the world is her domain. She sees herself going to Europe. She sees herself going to America. I prophesy on somebody's life today that in the name above every other name, you will not be limited to Laham. You will not be limited to Gettysburg. In the mighty name of Jesus. Don't blame everyone, anyone. Once you blame that, you are saying that you are bigger, that your problem is bigger than Christ. Your problem should lead you to a testimony. Your challenge should lead you to a testimony. Brother, you must set the mind of possibility thinking. Someone say possibility thinking. Someone say possibility thinking. For you to say there is no way is to say there is no Jesus. God will make a way where there seems to be no way. We start seeking his presence every year with zero budget. Zero. Zero budget. Committee members now know that God, at the end of the day, Baliko was texting me, was it on Friday? Baliko said, Pastor, how are you? I said, I'm fine. Oh, he said, you are still around? I said, yes. He said, okay. So that I will know what I'm going to do after Sunday. Maybe I'm going to flee. Because of the bills we have to pay. I said, Baliko, if you are not coming on Sunday, you won't even see me on Saturday. But our God, at the end of the day, he meets all our bills. We have not forced anyone to give. People have given voluntarily. All we have to do is to pray. All we have to do is to invite. And God has gone before us. But it is what you must do in your life. When people say no to you, don't let it affect you. No, it does not affect me. I will go there and look at you. They will say no. I say, it's okay. I'll move to another one. I've told you about customer service at Chevy Chase Bank. Is that true? There was a time in my life, God is taking me out of that. Has taken me in Jesus' name. I think about maybe 7-8 years ago, and somebody called me. He said, Pastor, all this thing, we are trying it. I wrote a check, and I think I wrote like 4 or 5 of them, and they got there at the same time. So something happened. They called it non-sufficient fund. And unfortunately, those that I wrote it and gave it to, instead of not to present it one time, they presented it like 2 times. Every spirit of presenting all the time. So what happened? At the end of the day, like 10 or 12 of them, on this my humble self, a servant of God. So I called the person. Hello, how are you? How are you doing? It's a beautiful day in Maryland. Is it a beautiful day out there? He said, it's okay. What's your name? I said, no, I'm saying hello to you. I need to pipe the person down very well. Don't let nobody say no to you. Oh, what's the problem? If you look at my record, some things happened. I have like about 12. How many do I have there? I pretend as if I didn't know. How many do I have there? I say, oh, you have a couple. How many? Like 12. Oh, it's up to 12? Wow, I didn't know. What can you do to help me? Oh, I ain't got no authority to do this. You have no authority. Oh, but God will promote you. I said, what do you say? I said, God will promote you. Can you transfer me to your manager? This one, because I know the next paycheck is already in trouble. If you have 350, when the next one comes, for 1 year you are, you know how this thing happens. So I was like, okay, I'll take away 4. Oh, thank you very much. I'll drop the phone. I'll call again. Hello, how are you? I saw that they just removed 4, but I want to know what you can do for me. You keep on pressing forward. Do not allow anyone to say no to you. And at the end of the day, brethren, if you are persistent, you see how God will help you. Am I talking to somebody? Brethren, let's quickly look at this. Proverbs 9:12. It says, if you are wise, your wisdom will reward you. If you're a mocker, you alone will suffer. If you are wise, your wisdom will reward you. If you are wise, your wisdom will reward you. Brethren, why don't you try to be wise and do what is right in the eyes of the Lord? As seeking his presence moves on, don't let what we have learned depart from us. Listen to the tapes, practice what you have learned. This scripture is very powerful. It says, if you are wise, in some sense, another version says, if you are foolish, you are foolish unto yourself. So therefore, you must understand this thing and begin to walk in the principles of the Lord. Well, we read in the book of Mark 6, the apostles said unto Jesus, let us send them away. Let us do what? Send them away. And Jesus said in verse 37, you have to give them something to eat. It was a logical thing that he said. He said, these people, they are going to eat. There's no food here. We are in the wilderness. And so let us send them away. Where it's still, if it's not night yet, let them go and look for something to eat. And Jesus said, you must give them something to eat. Jesus was trying to tell the disciples that if you have to walk with me, you don't go about giving what? Excuses. That it's your responsibility to understand that you have to make provision for your family, make provision work for everything around you. You have to be ready to do something with your life. Said, give them something to eat. Don't give excuses here. Life is more than excuses. A lot of us every day, what we do is what? Excuses, excuses, excuses. And I pray that the Lord Almighty will help us in Jesus' name. After he said so, you know what disciples said? They said unto Jesus, this man is not hearing us. He's not hearing us at all. And he said to him, shall we go and buy 200 denarii worth of bread and give them something to eat? Now it seems you don't understand us, sir. What we are saying is that we don't have money, it's in the wilderness. Who's going to supply us this bread at this time? They were complaining. They were giving excuses. Brethren, for you to walk with God, you must live a life of no excuses. When the Lord says go, you will do what? You will go. Pastor Adebayo was saying to us, and it surprised me because I was teaching about the Ephesians 2:10. I was teaching about it in the naming ceremony that I went to, and the two naming ceremonies, that we must transition from a child to what? A son. A son does not give excuse. No. As a leader, as a child of God, your 9 should be 9, your 2 should be 2. It's about understanding discipline and not living to a life of excuse. As you go to your next level, I pray that excuses will not function there. Amen. I didn't hear that. I said excuses will not function there. Amen. A couple went to a man of God and they said to a man of God, I had a dream. And he said some things were being aborted in my life and the rest. And the man of God said, what you need to do is to pray and to fast. The man said, I don't have the gifting of fasting. And the man said, maybe you don't have the gifting of destiny then. Because the Bible says, some things will never go except by what? How are you living your life, brethren? Don't give excuses. I see a lot of people in this country without papers, and they are doing well. Is that true? With God, all things are possible. I used to know somebody. He did not have papers. We had Pastor Jack was the example. But let me just go on. He went to the immigration officer. They said he should come. He said he had a driver's license or something. When he got there to the immigration people, the immigration said, where's your driver's license? As he was bringing everything out of his wallet, the picture of his daughter fell down. And the immigration person said, beautiful daughter. I said, yes, thank you very much. He did not have the part they were looking for. I said, okay, just check that thing. But if there are some people, they will not go for that interview. Is that true? They will say, what will I show them there? Forgetting the fact that Moses had no power to divide the Red Sea, but at the same time, he made himself available at the Red Sea. Did I say something? And when he got there, the Red Sea parted. Brethren, as we go out this week, brethren, as you go out after seeking his presence, no more excuses. You must go out ready to do excellence. Send that proposal. Don't bother about it. When you go for that presentation, have the tenacity that God is going to help you. And trust me, he will do what? He will help you. Am I saying something to somebody? Am I saying something to somebody? Accept responsibility for change. Don't look at everybody. Don't excuses all the time. No, it's not going to work. Number two, are you being blessed? Take stock of what you have. Take stock of what you have. So, Adora, you're not writing, you're not doing anything. In the story we read, Jesus said, ask, what do you have? He asked them. And they said, we have 5 loaves and 2 fishes, they said. Brethren, it is important that before we come before the Lord, we take stock of what we have. A lot come before the Lord, they've not taken a stock of what we have. The man of God said, what do you want the Lord to do for you? Is that true? What do you have in your home? The man of God said so. You must take stock of what you have. Before you come to the Lord in prayer and in service, you must take stock of what you have. Many will say, Pastor, that is the exact problem. I don't have anything. And that is a lie. God can never form you without giving you something to live on this earth. I say that categorically to us. Every one of us, every man, every woman, young and old, you have some innate thing that God has given unto you and that God is waiting for you to discover. And by the grace of God, you will discover it and God Almighty will use you for your next level. In the mighty name of Jesus. God will never allow you to the point of having nothing. The widow said, I don't have anything. The man of God said, there's something in your house. What is the talent that you have? What is it that you know how to do? You must be flexible. You must be what? Flexible. You must have studied something elsewhere in Africa. Maybe you have studied something. You have studied animal husbandry. And you get to America, animal husbandry is not working. All the animals, they already have husband. Look for another one. Am I saying something? You have to look for something else to do. By the grace of God, I, this humble person, I went to the University of Ibadan. After the third time, it did not happen. I wanted to read law, and I said, this fourth time, I must leave home. You know how it is. I must leave home. First choice, history. Second choice, history. Third choice, history. I don't care. But today, see what God has done with my life. It is not all about what you read. It is all about what God is ready to do with your life. Am I saying something? Be flexible. Don't say, oh, I came to America, this is what I studied. Look for something else to do. Be ready. This year, I think this year, our church, we assisted almost 28 people to learn new things to make them live in this land. You must be ready to look onto other horizons. Brethren, a lot of things that I do are not things that I have done before, but I am ready to learn. You must be ready to learn. You have something in your life, and God Almighty will allow you to discover those things in Jesus' name. Take stock of what you have. You take stock of relationships. Someone say relationships. Someone say relationships. When the average man talks about wealth, he talks about money, not knowing that relationships too is much more than wealth. I looked at myself yesterday at the concert, and I said to myself, wow, Pastor Larry, you are wealthy. Why am I wealthy? I see all these people around me. You understand what I'm saying, man? I see all these wonderful people around me, working for the Lord tenaciously. And I said, I'm one of the most wealthiest pastors on the face of the earth. Because human beings, we are one of the most important treasures in life. The woman of God did not know that her being connected with Elisha was what was going to help her get to success. Relationship. Relationships matter. I have a property somewhere, and some people came in to check the property. And as we were talking, I discovered that they attend a church that I know the pastor very well. Very, very well. The pastor is my mentor. Oh. And I said, wow, you are from that church? I said, yes. I said, trust me, you already have this property. Because I cannot say before your pastor and say that I declined a member of his church a property that I have. Am I saying something? Is that not connection? Is that not wealth? Brethren, you look around. The next person beside you may be the person that's going to help you. I was in a church, my first breakthrough in life in America, my first job with the IRS, $47,000, was by somebody in our church. I looked everywhere, almost 300 resumes I sent out. 300. I don't care. I will send it. Oh, I'll send this one again. What does it cost me? Send. Does it cost me anything? I'll just send. Not knowing that this person beside me. I pray for you today that which you have been waiting for, this week you shall be connected. Amen. In the mighty name of Jesus. Take stock of people that matters to you. Brethren, look at them. Of course, God is number one. You must not negotiate that. Number two, you must look at the man of God that God has placed in your life. Trust me. The man of God that God has placed in your life, that places value over you all the time, that ministers and prophesies and teaches you, you must understand. You must look at the people around you and divide them, like I have said, to three levels. Number one is what? Confidant. Number two is the what? Constituent. Number three is the what? Comrade. You divide them like that, and you take stock. You know where you are going to. And I pray that the Lord will help you in Jesus' name. Look for a mentor. Find a mentor. You must package yourself. Someone say, package yourself. Your future, you can write this down if you want to write this down. Your future is packaged in your seed talents. Your future is packaged in your what? Seed talent. Your future is packaged in your seed talent. What God has given unto you, it is a seed, but that seed, as small as it is, it has a lot of potency in it. And if you don't sow it, it's not likely to go anywhere. So you must understand that. Your future is packaged in your seed talent. Package yourself very well. Don't go for an interview looking ragged. Shine your shoe very well. I must say something. Rehearse what you are going to say. Understand. Do your own due diligence. Appear there clean and sharp. And you see what God will do in your life. Are we getting something today? Number three. Concentrate on your area of strength. Concentrate on your what? Area of strength. Know your talents, your strengths, and areas of weakness. You must know it. Now, if I decide to begin to sing, I have missed it in life. Completely missed it in life. Two ministers have come here and said I should not sing. But I will not in any form stop singing. At least, you will still encourage me, is that true? Pastor Kalejai said, Pastor, don't be singing. I said, sir, this church, I was continuing to sing. Pastor Adibi said, you are still singing. Are you still singing? I said, I will even sing today. But I know that is not my calling. And you guys know what my calling is. My calling is anyone that meets with me, I want to make them better than I met with them. That is my calling in life. You must understand your areas of strength. You must understand what can you do better than anyone else. What can you do better than anyone else? Three things you must know. What can you do better than anyone else? You must know that thing. What can you do better than anyone else? Understand that. I know what Mercy City Chapel is able to do. We work on our strength. What can you do with greater ease than anyone else? What can you do with what? Greater ease than anyone else. Well, anyone else. If you ask someone now to install on a computer a software, it might take that person 1 hour. Is that true? When I get there, it won't take me 5 minutes. That is my strength. Am I saying something? You must understand what you do with ease. What you do with ease. You must understand it. What do you know that most people don't know? What do you know that most people don't know? What do you know that most people don't know? You must understand that. So once you understand all these things, then that is what your area of strength is. Don't let your weaknesses get in the way of you reaching your full potential. Focus and do very well at your strength and capitalize on it. Brethren, this example that I gave to us sometimes ago when I treated this topic, where you know, how do you know your strength? And how do you know what to concentrate on? Between 1 and 10, 8 and 9 is the excellent, or 10 is the excellent, and 5 is the in-between. And you have a skill. And if you look at the skill set that you have, like 3 of the skill set that you have, number one, your strength there is 3. Another one, your strength there is what? 5. Another one, your strength there is what? 6. Remember, where you are trying to get to is what? 10. What many of us do is spend a lot of time on number 2. You live day and night on number 2. Oh, I'm trying to increase number 2. I'm trying to increase number 2. How do I get to number 2? Forgetting the fact that it's easier for you to spend every energy on number what? 6. So that you quickly get to number what? 10. Did I say something to somebody? So locate what that skill is. I know what that skill is in my life. And I'm just going to concentrate on that. And it gets me to where I need to get to. Don't spend too much time on number 2. It will not help your life. Did I say something? I need your response, church. Did I say something? Spend quality time on number 6. Why do I know this? But then, if you look at people in life, if you look at the Michael Jordans, if you look at the Messi that plays soccer, if you look like Yaya Toure, the African footballer of the year for 3 times running. All these players, brethren, they concentrate on their place of strength. Is that true? If you move them from the position they play and you move them somewhere else, will they function? I need your response, please. No, they will not function. So therefore, you must understand that your area of skill is what takes you before kings and takes you before big people. Brethren, Michael Jordan, after playing basketball, what did he say to himself? He was going to try baseball. Did he fail or did not fail? He failed big time because that is not his area of strength. What is your area of strength? What is the area of strength of this church? Live in it, brethren, and you see where God will take you. But then another thing that you should be careful of when we talk about that is don't be stuck with education. Don't be stuck with what? Education. Revelation is superior to education. Africans, we love degrees. Oh, you see some people 3, 4, 5 degrees. When they go for interview, they pack the degrees. Trust me, in this part of the world, degree is important, but trust me, your skill set is much more better. Your experience is much more better than what? Degree. Oh, first degree, second degree, they amass it. But your skills, what you know how to do, your strength is much more better than your degree. Africans go to interviews with loads of degrees. In America, they care about results, not the degrees that you have. Education is very important. It gives you skills. It refines your talent, brethren. It is from the Greek word eduko, which means to induce or to bring out what is inside of you. To induce or to bring out what is inside of you. What is inside of you is much more than what you went to school to study. So education only brings what is inside of you into limelight. You can do any single thing because you're already educated. Your thinking faculty has been enlarged. Therefore, it is very easy for my wife to study Greek economics in UI and today being an accountant. It's very easy for me to study history and international relations and today become an IT person, a computer person. Don't let that education, don't be stuck in that education. Oh, I read chemistry. Oh, I read medicine. Oh, I read brethren, you must be versatile. If medicine is not happening for you, package yourself. Am I saying something? And look at what God has next for you. You're already educated. You have been fine-tuned. And look at the next thing that you can do. Because what kills a lot of us, I'm telling the truth, is what will people say? I studied medicine. Let me tell you something. They're already saying something already. Two of us. They're already saying something. That, hello, where did you hear from Akuzu? That's my nickname. Where did you hear from somebody? They say, oh, we heard from me. Has he found something? For where? In America. You have to take it 3 times. He had tried the first one twice. It had not even happened. Eh? Ha! And that guy was very brilliant when you were in school. Yes, he was very, very brilliant. But today it's not happening. They're already saying something about you. Am I saying the truth? So why don't you just, it's not happening there. Repackage yourself. Believe in the Bible. Take stock. And look for something else. You're already educated. And I pray God for you. I pray to God for you that God will reveal that thing to you. In the mighty name of Jesus. Don't tie yourself to your degree. Don't panic. In the book of Joshua 1:8, God said to Joshua, like about 4 times, God said to him, Joshua, be of what? Good courage. Be of good courage. Be of good courage. Be of good courage. I want to say to members of Mercy Chapel, I just thank God for what God is doing in the life of everybody. I just want to thank God. My daughters are getting married. People are buying homes. People are going to new businesses. And I know as from today, new things will begin to happen. In the mighty name of Jesus. Don't panic. Don't be afraid. Firefighters will tell you smoke kill more than fire. Is that true? Smoke kill more than fire. So if you're afraid of the fire and you are not afraid of the smoke, you are likely to die faster. Oh, the fire is burning there. I'm not moving close to it before they come and you are inhaling the smoke. It is what? It is dead. So don't panic. It is going to be well with you. Don't panic. God got your back. Don't panic. Just focus on God and you see great things that God will do in your life. Just look unto him, the author and the finisher of your faith, and you'll see how God will help you. If you're afraid, you'll get stuck at the shore. You'll just be there. You are so afraid. But then at a point, I was into full-time ministry, and things were not really happening. My income got reduced almost 60%. And I said to myself, I got to do something about this. I'm not going to be stuck here. And I cannot steal church money. And church, trust me, I'm telling you, there's no way. The life that I've been living before I became a pastor, for me to leave it, I must do something for my, I have children, I have family to take care. Is that true? Talk to me, is that true? Yes. I gotta do something. And the money was even, the money was not even there to steal. You know, there's a way the money is there, but this one, it was not even available. So I said, I gotta do something by myself. So I repackaged myself. I began to go to Africa to look for something to do. You guys, you know the story, and God has helped me. But then you must be ready. You must be ready not to be stuck at the shore. be ready to move to greater horizons. Don't panic. God is on your side. People will say whatever they want to say about you. Don't worry about it. One thing I want you to know, at times you might be afraid. Oh, I'm afraid. I want you to look at this quote and look at it and write it very, very well. Courage is not the absence of fear, but the conquest of fear. Courage, forget this, is the spirit, it will always attack you. Forget that part. Courage is not the absence of fear, but the conquest of fear. When you say somebody has courage, brethren, it's not that because the person is not fearful. Did I say something? If you say, oh, I'm courageous, it's not because the person is not fearful, but the person has conquered fear to a certain extent. Did I say something to somebody? Write it down very well, and please, every time, begin to look at it. Courage is not the absence of fear. It's not because fear is absent. No. Fear is there. But one thing you have done, you have eliminated or reduced fear to a certain extent. Did I say something? Brethren, when you start something, you are likely to fail. When you start something, you are likely to fail. But what you must understand is reduce the failure rate to a minimum that you are able to go out. Did I say something? When you start something, there's a likelihood that you are going to fail. But what you must understand is that you must reduce that failure rate to a bare minimum that you are now comfortable in doing what? In stepping out. I have fear. Trust me, anytime we do a program, I always have fear. And trust me, anytime I come to preach, every Sunday I come to preach, ask my wife, I'm palpitating that God, you must help me to deal. You must help me. But the bad office here, you're looking at me, call this here. God, help me that I must deliver. I'm telling you the truth. But how do I know? I eliminate it by preparing. Is that true? So you are eliminating to a certain extent that you know that they will take today. You know that, you know what I mean? Are you taking today?
Yes.
Okay. Let's give the round of applause. Oh, men didn't get that joke. So courage is not the absence of fear. Let me tell you something, brethren, as we are seated here now, if you ask every one of us to go out and we off the light and we say come back in, you are likely to have confidence to come back in. Why? Because you already know this place. Is that true? So you can find your, that's why you go to the bathroom at night in your house and you don't put on the light and you go and you come back safely and nothing happens because you know the terrain. Is that true? But if you now bring someone who was not here with us, a late comer that came around maybe 11 after praise worship has been done and they met us outside and you ask the person to go first, from there to this place, all their knees will be broken. What am I saying? We have eliminated fear. Is that true? Then we can step out. How do you eliminate fear? By educating yourself. By learning what you want to do. I'll tell you, when I wanted to start a Subway, I was thinking of going to work in Subway. I'm the owner, but I'll go to one Subway and learn. So what would that do to me? You'll not tell me that one bag of lettuce can only serve two people. I will know how this thing works. So you must understand what you want to do. You must learn what you want to do. I gave somebody an assignment. I said, this assignment, you must buy a book and read it and understand it so that you are successful about it. Many of us will go somewhere. We went to Canada to go to church to see what they are doing. You must be willing to learn. Did I say something? You must be willing to learn. And you must learn from a mentor, somebody that is doing well. Did I say something? Someone that is doing well. Go to them and learn. If you want to sing, you go to Minister Amoson. How do you sing? How do you do? What are the things that you don't? What do you do? I'm so grateful yesterday when I saw members of the church side by side with great men of God. Don Mwen, Aremu, Falaki Omoson, and I'm like, these are members of our church. Let someone appreciate the name of the Lord. So, brethren, these are the things that you need to do. You gain knowledge not to fail. First of all, you want to fail, but you gain knowledge not to fail. And once you understand all these things, these three principles, you'll see how God will help you. The number four that I wanted to talk about was recreation that Pastor Adebi spoke to us about. Brethren, do not forget that ministration. Don't let it just go. Go and write it down somewhere. Recreate yourself in Christ. Forget the old things. Release yourself unto the Almighty God. You want to be a worker. Why you want to be a worker? It's just to participate and to do what God has asked you to do. And I pray that God will help us in Jesus' name. I profess on somebody's life, the name above every other name, the Lord that has formed you, the Lord that has created you, He did not create you to suffer. He created you for signs and wonders. As you set foot upon this world, as you set foot upon this place today, I stand here today in the place of my authority, and I declare that on the face of this earth, you will receive purpose, and you will live in purpose, and you will actualize your purpose in the mighty name of Jesus. I pray, Lord Almighty, from heaven, that the resources we need, the tenacity that we need to be successful, the Lord will release upon us. The talent that we have in us, not only we will hear with mouth all every time. Somebody will always tell me, Pastor, I'm blessed by your message. I'm blessed by your message. And you are not walking by that message. Brethren, you are just deceiving yourself. If you gain knowledge and you walk in that knowledge, you apply that knowledge, it takes you somewhere. I pray that as many as here today, Lord Almighty, not only will they receive the word, they will walk the word in the mighty name of Jesus. They will not be like thorns that eat up the seed. Your seed shall not be eaten. Your seed talent shall not be eaten. In the mighty name of Jesus, I declare us as a candidate of God's favor, as a candidate of God's blessing, in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, Lord, we thank you. Ancient of Days, we glorify you. For in Jesus Christ's name, we have prayed. Amen.